I told you that it was Good Shepherd Sunday. We have a little theme going on here. It's very evident. There is the King of Love, my shepherd is. Our closing hymn will be Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us. And of course, passage in John. We had the 23rd Psalm. I left that one out. Whoops. 23rd Psalm. And of course, the passage in John that talks about, you know, Jesus telling them that he's the shepherd. So John chapter 10, and I'm going to start with verse 10, even though the lectionary starts at 11, and you'll see why. It says this: "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly." Verse 11, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Verse 16 says this: "I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father." May God add his blessing to the reading of the gospel for this morning. Gospel of John. Thanks be to God. The way Jesus starts out this discourse here in John is by painting a picture of two characters. One is a thief, and the other is a good shepherd. And because he calls himself the good shepherd, he then explains what he means by introducing a third character, the hired hand. So, why does Jesus feel the need to say all this about himself? What's this context here? Who is he talking to? "I am the good shepherd. The thief comes in to steal. I'm the good shepherd. The hired hand just runs away when there's a threat. I'm the good shepherd." So this passage goes back to signs and wonders and how the religious authorities at the time were questioning him. Because if you go back in your Gospel of John to chapter 9, the entire chapter of chapter 9 is Jesus healing the man born blind, who I write in my notes, man-born-blind. Because he doesn't have a name, that's what we call him, the man born blind. They come to him and interrogate him, the man born blind, who doesn't have a name. The religious authorities come to the man and they, you know, interrogate him. They ask him these questions. And he says famously, anybody know this one? "All I know is, I was blind and now I see." That's what he says. That's how he replies. "Well, tell me, who sinned? What happened? What is this all about? Who do you say that he is?" Wait, let me stop you there. "All I know is I was blind, and now I see. There's the value for me in this." But they said to him, "Shut up. You know nothing. You were born in sin." And they threw him out. Because he responded, this is the man born blind, because he replied that way. So they throw out the man born blind, and this is where the story picks up, just preceding the Good Shepherd discourse. It says Jesus heard that they had driven him out. Now I'm reading from chapter 9, verses 35. And when he found out, he said to him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And he answered, "And who is he, sir?" I mean, this guy, he's hedging his bets. "Tell me, so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him. He is the one who's speaking to you, is he?" And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. The man born blind worshipped Jesus. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees who were with him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" And Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." And that's it. Then he goes on to talk about some other things, and then the idea of a thief. And a thief that comes in and steals and destroys and kills. And he's not that guy. He's a good shepherd. He's not the hired hand either. He's not the guy that cuts and runs, you know, hedging his bets when the going gets tough. He's the good shepherd. He lays down his life for his sheep, if that's necessary. And this discourse seems to be directed to the religious authorities, this part about, "I am the good shepherd." Jesus explaining to them about who he is. We know his disciples and other followers were probably there too. And ultimately, what we understand is that the Johannine community, the community that this gospel was written towards, to influence that community, was the intended audience. So what's the point? Jesus saying all this stuff about himself to these religious leaders. Point is that Jesus needs to clarify, or the writer of the fourth gospel needs to inform his community, who he is by identifying who he is not. Apparently, he is not like the religious authorities. Apparently, he is not a thief or a robber that jumps the fence and sneaks in to steal and kill and destroy. Nor is he a hired hand that abandons the sheep when the wolf approaches. No, Jesus is the good shepherd. And he says he knows his sheep, and his sheep know him. And he lays down his life for his sheep. Okay. Why this example? Surely the simple people who work in animal husbandry may relate to this, but that's not everybody. And it certainly isn't those religious authorities that he's talking to. I mean, Jesus is not winning this argument by any stretch of the imagination. He's not clobbering them over the head with his power and might and glory. Now, he's just healed somebody from being blind. And then he tells them, "You know what? I'm the good shepherd, laying down my life for the sheep." So, the understanding, and this isn't like a new thing, and this isn't exclusively an old thing, is that, you know, the people that took care of the sheep, even if you look in the Bible, they were all of the lower class. Well, you know, the youngest children and or the girls would be the ones caring for the flocks. Like Rebecca at the well when she meets Isaac, she's caring for the flocks. I think it's Rachel. I meant to say Rachel, not Rebecca. I wish their names didn't start with the same letter. Anyway, Rachel's there at the well, you know, and that's Jacob and Rachel, right. So he takes the stone off and waters her herds for her. But the reason why she's going there is because it would be beneath a man or an older child to be a shepherd. Remember the youngest son of Jesse, David? The reason why he was good with the slingshot was because he was tending the sheep. This is the low job on the totem pole. And everybody knows it. And I'm sure those religious authorities knew it too. And they were baffled by this. So this man, he can forgive sins and like make miracles happen, and he's calling himself a shepherd? what is the point? Jesus is losing this argument. But I think the reason why Jesus wanted to say this in this part, the reason why he wanted people to know that he's a shepherd, I think it has something to do with the nature of sheep. Because sheep are amazing. Did you know that?
Did you know when depressed, sheep hang their heads and avoid company? But if content, they socialize and wag their tails like puppies. Rams lean against stone walls so that other sheep can stand on their backs to reach high grasses. Sheep recognize each other by facial features, and when shown photographs, they can remember at least 50 other sheep and 10 human beings, even if they haven't seen them for 2 years.
He wants you to drive them out of the yard.
Away to me, pig!
Remember, you have to dominate them. Do that, and they'll do anything you want. Go, go!
Woof! Woof, woof, woof! Woof! Woof, 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 woof!
This is ridiculous, Mom.
Nonsense. It's only your first try. But you're treating them like equals. They're sheep. They're inferior.
Oh, no, they're not.
Of course they are. We are their masters, babe. Let them doubt it for a second and they'll walk all over you.
Hey!
They'll laugh at me.
Then bite them. Be ruthless. Whatever it takes, bend them to your will.
Enough!
Go on. Go.
What's got into you all of a sudden? I just got finished telling what a nice young pig you be.
Ma, I was just trying to be a sheepdog.
Huh, enough wolves in the world already. Without a nice lad like you turning nasty. You haven't got it in you, young'un.
I'm sorry I bit you. Are you all right?
Well, I wouldn't call that a bite myself. You got teeth in that floppy mouth of yours or just gums?
See, ladies, a heart of gold. No need for all this wolf nonsense, young'un. All a nice little pig like you need do is ask.
That a little gentility and some mutual respect goes a long way. It's a great film, and it's from like 94, I think, 95, and it's still good. It's still valuable. But sheep are not what we think they are. And you know what? Sheep are a lot like us. It's pretty on the nose, like how similar they are to human beings. You can't be too rough with sheep. Sheep are afraid of things that they don't understand. They don't like loud noises. They don't like unfamiliar places. Sound familiar, though? You see, what Jesus is saying is that unless your leadership style is steal, kill, and destroy, you ought to be gentle. If you want to get somewhere as a shepherd, you need to know something about sheep, that they respond to gentility. Sure, I guess Jesus did understand. But this really says volumes about who Jesus really is, essentially. You see, that steal, kill, and destroy, those power and influence over people, is fine for some, but not for Jesus. People who fight and threaten others aren't standing in the same lane as Jesus of Nazareth. They might claim his name, but they need to go back and read up. His power and authority comes from being the one who lays down his life for his sheep. So why do we, in his name, lord over the sheep with threats and aggression? Because we are human and we mess up, sure. But we need to be strong enough to admit we are wrong. We go about this in the wrong way. We need to return to the scripture and read up. I don't think Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd," as just a one-off, to make a nice thing for later on people to paint pictures, or for some churches to name their buildings after. The whole idea of telling those religious authorities that he is a good shepherd is a countercultural event. I looked up some of our Christian brethren who really do the business. You know, the mega churches. You know what I'm talking about when I say mega church? And would you believe there is not one of them that I could find that is called the Good Shepherd? Now, plenty of churches are named Good Shepherd, but not those big dogs. No, 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 no. Their, you know, names are like the region, the city, or they use words like new and hope and fellowship and life and Christ and Calvary and first. You know, that's a big, good name of churches. First, that's everywhere in the Bible, isn't it? There are plenty of churches named Good Shepherd, but they aren't the megas. They aren't the startups. Those folks didn't get into this to be humble. They want to make a difference in the world. They want to see their mark. They're not going to call themselves shepherds. And they're not going to really acknowledge this critical point that Jesus and kind of God, hello, that's also in the Psalms, is trying to make about who God is. You see, they're trying to build a different kingdom. Whose kingdom? I don't know. Well, that depends on the day, I guess. But our culture rejects this idea of gentleness. We can't be gentle. It doesn't get us anywhere, folks. Jesus spends 2 chapters in John's gospel trying to explain who he is not. That this isn't the way you think it is. He says to the religious authorities, "I am the good shepherd." And they go, "What?" You know, we're going to have this general conference this coming week, and there's going to be a lot of very important people there. You know, bishops, delegates. Even Heather was telling me, she said, "This is the first time I'm a delegate." And all these other folks, especially the clergy, they know so much more about the legislative agenda and all the things that are happening. And maybe if we want to pray for something, we can pray for our church to be the church of the Good Shepherd. To follow who we see evidenced here in the gospel. A person of gentility. A person who says the first shall be last and the last shall be first. A person that doesn't need dominance and power in order to be strong in the world and to increase the faith. No, no, no. Jesus was about a different kind of power and a third way. The kind of power that says, I will lay down my life for my sheep. I will devote myself to this endeavor. The early church, they gathered everything that they had. And if they had any extra, they gave it away. I wonder how much the denomination will decide to give away at the General Conference. As the mainline church and even some of the megas desperately tries to hold on to what they have now. The institutional church may have the cracks and the crumbles, and the people on treadmills trying every day, struggling hard, hard, hard to keep it going, to keep it up, to keep it built. But what happens to the other sheep? Let me go back to the passage. Remember Jesus said that part about there's other sheep who don't belong to this flock, but they're my sheep nonetheless, and they'll hear my name and they'll follow me? If we're really, really concerned about keeping our pen built up, taking care of our own sheep, how are we going to be out there with those other sheep that Jesus identifies in this passage as belonging? You know, there's a responsibility there to some degree that we emulate a good shepherd. I wonder how important gentleness is to you in your life. Well, it's certainly important when you receive it. When you have someone in your life who is gentle with you. I have to confess myself, I'm not always the gentlest person when I'm acting towards others. Gentility is a step further. And when Paul talks about it as a fruit of the Spirit, he really means that we ought to be gentle. Gentle with each other. Gentle with ourselves. And some of us need to hear that more than others. And gentle to those who we see as beyond our scope of social influence. That gentility carries in as a mindset and a worldview. It's not just one of those words that Paul said is the fruit of the Spirit. When we see people being gentle to other people, we understand, look, they must be following that good shepherd. And so I would encourage all of us, especially as we pray for the next 2 weeks in our church, that there might be an attitude of gentleness. An attitude of one who emulates and follows this good shepherd. Because, folks, the thief comes in and their leadership style is to destroy and kill. And it was one more thing, but I forgot what it was. But, you know, it was not good. And then you have the hired hand over here. It was just like, okay, I've got this. Oh, wait, there's a threat. That looks familiar, right? Yeah, I mean, even in the church, you got leaders who do that. Oh, wait, no, okay, I gotta go. No. The good shepherd steps forward. This is more people are gonna hate this. The good shepherd is the one that steps forward. Not to steal or to kill, but to give his life for the sheep. Amen. Closing hymn, as promised, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.